Hello everybody and welcome to Dark DJ Productions. And today on Dark Tries, we're going to be having a look at this. This is the London and North Eastern Railway Gresley A3 Class Pacific, brought to Train Simulator Classic by Caledonia Works. Now, this class of locomotive likely doesn't require much of an introduction. However, I will give you a few facts and a brief history of the class. So, the A3 Pacifics were designed by Sir Nigel Gresley for the London and North Eastern Railway for express work. They are a development and rebuild of the A1 Pacifics, also designed by Gresley. In total, 78 locomotives were built or rebuilt to the A3 configuration, and this was completed between 1928 and 1949. The class were built for express work. They worked for the LNER throughout the system's operations, so the company's operations, and they operated throughout the Second World War, and they passed into British Railways ownership in 1948. They lasted up until the late 50s, early 60s. Unfortunately, only one member of the class survives, and it is the world famous, probably the most famous steam locomotive in the world, number 4472, Flying Scotsman, which has had a very colourful history in preservation. But more on that either in another video or later on. So, that's a sort of brief introduction to the A3s. So, we're going to have a look around at the model. We're going to have a look at what's included in the pack, and we're going to go for a little drive with one of the A3s. So, a few things to note first of all. First things first, this has a couple of customization options. You can change the smoke box to have either the burnishing or not on a few of the variations. You can change the dome to either be the smaller dome of the sort of Great Northern pattern or the banjo dome that was later adopted by Gresley. You have three different tender variations. You've got the Great Northern Railway Coal Rail tender, you've got the non-corridor LNER Gresley tender, and you have the corridor LNER Gresley tender. There's also a few more variations later on in BR days, such as where the front number plate sits and whether it's got smoke deflectors or whether it's got a double or a single chimney. But that's all variations that we'll look at in a little while. We've also got all the variations of Flying Scotsman in preservation, some of which I haven't put down for the sake of them all looking very similar, but the major ones I have put down, such as the America Tour and the sort of modern day versions that are included. So with that little bit of a preamble out of the way, shall we have a look at the liveries that are included in the pack? So, we will start with what is probably the most famous livery worn by the A3 Pacifics, and this is, of course, LNER Apple Green. So, I'll bring the camera around so we can have a look at it. You'll be able to see as we start moving the camera around as well, if I've done this correctly, that you can see that this one has the burnished hinges and the smokebox dart, whereas the one next to it, and a fair majority of them going forward, don't have the burnishing. It's mainly on the LNER Apple Green version, but you can also see the difference in the buffers. So you've got the quartered buffers on the Apple Green, and you haven't got the quartered buffers on the ones going forward, mostly, of course. Some of the preservation ones may well have it, but we shall have a look shortly. So this is just sort of a pan around so you can have a look at the livery. Obviously it's in shadow, so it doesn't really give it that much of a it's not really doing it justice. But you can see the general shape of the locomotive at least. You can see the livery. You can see the number there, number 2547 for Doncaster. All of the nameplates are 3D for all 78 members of the class. And of course, with all the liveries, you also get the tenders in all of the liveries. So if you would like to have a Great Northern Railway coal rail tender with the Apple Green, like here, you can. If you want to have a non-corridor tender, you can. If you want to have a BR Brunswick one with a non-corridor tender, you can. And if you want an Ultramarine with a Great Northern tender, you can. There's a lot of customizability in this pack. So if I bring the camera right back here, We are seeing a few more liveries from the future, but from this angle, you can see the different variations of the tenders. So on the left, you've got the corridor tender. In the middle, you've got the non-corridor tender. And on the right, you've got, obviously, the cold rail tender. And if I scooch the camera this way, you can see you can pretty much have any combination of livery with any combination of tender. So in regard to tenders, this pack is mega. Absolutely mega. So I'm going to come back round very quickly this side of Doncaster. Probably one of the sort of nicer named ones because it sort of means something, because obviously the Great Northern Railway and Doncaster Works and all that lot. So you've got, as I say, all 78 members. I've put a few down that I think are notable or that I like the names of. For example, Papyrus number 2750 in the Northeastern Wartime Black. This one was famous for having, I think it had the speed record for the class, something like 108 miles an hour. And that's something that I think was worth looking at. Another one that's actually quite famous is Humorist. I actually didn't put that one down, but Humorist is interesting because it's the one that had lots of smoke deflector, and well, not smoke deflector, you know, drafting experiments done to it. Unfortunately, all of those haven't made it into the pack, but that's quite obviously because there's so many to look at and they're all a bit complex for what the game's done. This locomotive is already quite complex as it is. So we've also got the post-war LNER Black, which is where they were renumbered. So you can see that number 2750 is on one side. This one is number 61. So this was the 1946 renumbering scheme, I believe. And so basically the main difference between them is the numbering sequence. And I think this one is Pretty Polly. Interesting name. So if we come up to the roof here, up to the top level, you can see the two different types of boiler slash dome. So you've got the banjo dome here at the front, so the elongated shape banjo dome, and you've got the original style Great Northern dome over there on that one. Those are changeable on almost every single locomotive as well. So if you want a locomotive that is in LNER Apple Green with a banjo dome, you can. And if you want one that's in, say, I don't know, BR Brunswick Green, but with a Great Northern style dome, you can. So yeah, that's the main difference in between the two wartime ones, at least. It may be the numbers. So if I scooch all the way back down here and clip through the locomotive because I'm silly, we've now got the next livery, which is post-war Apple Green. And the main difference here is that it's in Gill Sands, the text, so it's unshaded. So if I come down here, you can see that the text on the tender and on the side of the locomotive, they're not shaded anymore. And I think Gill Sands is probably one of the more famous liveries, fonts, mostly because it was used by British Railways afterwards. And I think this member is, oh, of course, it's one of my favourite members of the class. And it also makes me very hungry. Next to it, we've also got Victor Wilde, number, well, previously 4474, I think it was. Now in this British Railways Apple Green as 60105. So you can immediately see the sort of difference in the liveries there. You can see that we're going towards BR. So if I move it all the way back, you can also see the strangeness that the BR number plates are high up on the locomotive smoke box, which is a bit strange, but that's how it was. That's how BR decided they were going to have the smoke box number plate on these. I think it's something to do with the handrail being at the level that it would have been. But anyway, this is the British Railways Apple Green. And I know we've seen one side, but I thought we'd scooch around this side. And you can see you can have the Great Northern style tender with it. 60105, route availability there, British Railways there. And another one that's in British Railways, but this time it is Ultramarine making a return. And also number 60101. Hey, Cicero. So this is a really nice livery as well. It's an unusual livery, and I don't think anybody's ever going to quite get the livery right. It looks good, don't get me wrong, but I think I was speaking to someone about this a little while ago, which is that I don't think with old colour photographs you can ever get the colour quite correct. Like, each camera has a slightly different sort of, you know, I don't know how to explain it, but like, you know, shutter speed and, you know, exposure and all that lot. So I don't think the colour's ever going to be quite correct, but it does look all right. Maybe a little bit pale for my liking, But that could just be my own eyes. It could even just be my game setting, to be honest. But nicely applied livery all the same. And it does look interesting, I'll give it that. Same as the next livery, which is BR Blue. You can also see that it's got the Haymarket written there on the front. I don't know if those are actually changeable. I will have to look at some point. But next member of the class we've got here is Colorado. Okay, I'm not quite sure why I put that one down, but never mind. I suppose it's interesting. Might be a South Park reference, I suppose. Well, I know all the names are to do with racehorses, but I'm making a modern day joke. So you've got 60094, early crest for the BR Blue. And then next to it, we've got the first of the Brunswick. Now, there's actually four in total of the Brunswick, but I've put three of them down. Mainly because one of them is the BR Brunswick, and it's with a single chimney. The next one is with a double chimney. And the final one is with the smoke deflectors. I believe there's one with the smoke deflectors with the number plate higher. And then there's this one which has the number plate where I think it looks better, right in the middle there. So that's the BR Brunswick one. If I come round here, where I can actually see it properly, I think that looks really good, actually, with the German-style deflectors. I don't know why, though. I'm not normally a fan of the German-style deflectors. I think it looks 100% times better without them. But I think the combination of the deflectors with the number plate, wherever it is on this one, doesn't make it look all that bad. Again, sort of my theory that the A3 Pacifics are very handsome machines and they're very classical machines. Not quite sure if the blinkers help or not, the German style deflectors, but I don't know. We didn't even look at the names of these ones. Shall we have a look what I put down? So we've got Diamond Jubilee, which I think is kind of appropriate in a way. We've got Neil Cow. I love that nameplate. Anybody who wants to meme this, you can take the screenshot from here. Neil Cow. Who decided to name an engine Neil Cow? Then again, there is an engine called Sandwich. And then the final one is a bit of a reference for me anyway. The White Knight. Now, a lot of people might know why. But basically, one of my first computers that I started doing YouTubing with, and all my stuff on my channel, was called the White Knight. Because it was a really rubbish old laptop. So, I find it kind of funny that there was a locomotive called the White Knight. I think one of the other differences, actually, just looking at it, is that the inclusion of the overhead warning stickers on this later version of the A3. So, you know, at least that's quite a lot of bases covered, and that's just the Steam era versions. So you've got quite a lot of variety already, considering that you've got so many different combinations of tenders as well. Three different tender types, and all of these. Now, if we scooch back over here, and I'm hoping I've got this right, we can move this way, yeah, and we can start having a look at the preservation variants. Not every single one of them, of course, but this is probably what everybody recognises this locomotive for right here. So this is number 4472, Flying Scotsman, or as I like to nickname it because I'm petty, Flying Scrap Heap. But regardless, I'm going to put all of my prejudices out of the way, because at the end of the day, it is a very famous locomotive, and the fact that Caledonia Works has included so many different variants, so many variants in fact, that not even I can spot the differences on them, which is why I haven't put all of them down. I'm pretty sure that somebody somewhere will tell me all of the slight intricacies of Flying Scotsman in preservation, but I put the important one down. So this is how it would have been first preserved when purchased by Alan Pegler. So it would have just been repainted straight up into LNER Apple Green. Would have still had a banjo dome, and it would have had the red nameplates Flying Scotsman right there. Let's see. I can't actually think of what other differences would have been on this one, but you get the idea. This is probably, when you think of Flying Scotsman, this is what you think of, I'd imagine. Probably the most famous of the lot. Maybe slightly more famous, though, is the double tenders, which were the ones that were used by Flying Scotsman during its career on British Rail when Alan Pegler purchased it and was running rail tours with it. So this includes the, I think that's the LNER Crest. Somebody please inform me. I'm sure that's the LNER Crest. And it also had LNER written on the tender and the second tender number 4472. Now, the reason for the second tender, as most people already know, probably either through a famous story, book, thing, or just through knowing about Flying Scotsman, it's for extra water capacity, because during the time of it running rail tours, water towers were being ripped up on British Rail. So it needed extra water to run its rail tours. So a second Gresley tender was sort of hastily sort of purchased and converted into a water carrier, which, you know, gives it a bit of an interesting history. You've also got the change in the cylinder covers. You had the original LNER lining on one side, but then I think it was Alan Pegler himself wanted to have the cylinders painted green, so that's what happened. You also might have just sneakily noticed that I haven't actually got the regular version down. I've got the Flying Scotsman in America version down. So this is when it was fitted with giant headlamp, bell, and a giant chime whistle, and cow catcher, and a knuckle coupler, so it could be dragged around when it wasn't allowed to be pulled around on its own power. I have actually got this locomotive clicked on, and I will, very quickly, before I move on to the actual drive of the normal A3 that I'm going to drive, I will show you the bell and the whistle, although I'm pretty sure that I will be driving this in America at some point, if people would like to see that. If you would, then drop me a comment, like the video, all that stuff that YouTube likes me to say to bring up people to watch. So, if you'd like to see me do Flying Scotsman in America, then please do let me know in the comments as well. It's also got little flags as well, I've just noticed, which is kind of interesting. Interestingly modelled, at least. So yeah, that's the America one. There is a version that's for the Australian one, but I could not for the life of me see what the differences were. So I decided to move straight on to this one, which is the strange hybrid condition that Flying Scotsman was in during the late 90s, early 2000s, where it was painted LNER apple green, but it had the German smoke deflectors that it wouldn't have received until British Railways days. So it's an interesting combination. I'm glad it's in the pack because it's very strange, but it's also really bizarre to see. The other inclusion is something that I don't think I've really seen properly done before, which is the double tender, but with the BR blue style tender for the second one, which I think is really interesting, actually. I quite like that. It's a bit different, and it's also something that means it would have fit in while it was running rail tours with the BR blue era. And I think it also says, what's it say here? Flying Scotsman Enterprises. This would have been before it went to the National Railway Museum, of course. Speaking of the National Railway Museum, if we move back up to the front, we've got the wartime black Flying Scotsman from the sort of late 2010s, early 2010s, early 2010s, that's right, late 2000s, early 2010s. And this is the weird hybrid livery. Really even worse hybrid livery, I would say. There's a second one which I think is a bit more normal, but this one is like, it's screwing my brain, because you've got the BR number plate and BR shed code, you've got the BR style smoke deflectors, you've got double chimney, and you've also got the North Eastern Railway wartime black. But it's also got the number 103 on one side, just going to scoot through there, to show you that it's also got 502, which is its other LNER number, on that side. Because it would have been 502 originally, I think, and then it was renumbered to 103, which is why it ended up with the BR number 60103. And then finally is this one. This is Flying Scotsman in its modern day LNER... not LNER, what am I talking about? This is its modern day British Railways, thank you very much, me, Brunswick Green, which you can probably see from this distance, if I just scroll in like that, isn't the same shade of Brunswick Green as back there. This one is a much more vibrant colour, and I'm going to be the strange person to say, I actually really like this. Like, the more vibrant colour, at least. It's a bit more better than the sort of more darker, drabber sort of Brunswick Green. But this is basically the end of it, because this is the final livery to show you, because this is how it is in modern times. So that is the majority, I might add, of the locomotives in the pack. It's not every single one, because of obviously the tender variations and all the Flying Scotsman variations, but you kind of understand what I mean by that. That's basically all of the variations that we've got. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to unpause the game and I'm going to quickly show you the whistle and the bell on the America Flying Scotsman, and then we'll go and drive a regular A3 on the Settler Carlisle line, because that's the line we've loaded up on. The reason I'm doing it this way is because the game is going to lag like nobody's business once I unpause. So if we're ready, we shall now listen to the bell and the whistle on the American version, and then we'll go and look at the normal one. So here's the bell. I think I'm going to get the bell to work, which is done by, I think, Shift B. Come on. There you go. And then the chime whistle, or the American whistle at least. Which is controlled by the B key. So, I'm going to pause again. With that all out of the way, shall we go and actually drive one of the Caledonia Works A3 Pacifics? I think we should. So, with a jump cut, let's go. So, here we are at Carlisle Station with our noble steed for this little run to show off the A3 Pacifics. This is number 2506, and I'm not joking, its name is Salmon Trout. Yes, I'm not joking. It's a great name. So, we're going to watch the locomotive depart from the station. I've got the sounds up so we can listen to the sound of it leaving and maybe the whistle and whatnot. And then as we're going along, we'll have a look at the cab views. We'll have a look at some of the other features this locomotive has. And yeah, we will have a little drive of the Caledonia Works Gresley A3. So I'm going to unpause. I'm going to be quiet for a moment and we're going to watch this departure. So you want to get a nice camera view. Maybe other people will too. They remember driving in, having flying to Gotham. Set the Carlisle, bit of nostalgia, but obviously with a better simulator, most of them. See the locomotive comes with auto fireman, which you control R. Performance mode, which is shift P. You've also got simple mode and advanced mode, which is toggleable by control A, which basically just means that some of the controls are a little bit easier. Back to what we call classic control. You've got the decorations, which are what you saw at the front of the headboards and the lamps. That control 1, 2, 3, 4. Got the regular whistle, which is face bar, and then control and face bar for the sort of old whistle. So you got that one is control face, and that one, and then you got the loop one, which is face bar. And as we saw with the American Scotsman, that one has chime, which is double B, and then the bell is shift and B. So yeah, that's basically everything I've got to say on the LNER A3. So you've got 78 members of the class, you've got almost every variation that they would have worn commonly, I would add. Just missing a couple of the more strange experiment done to some of them, quite humorous, but completely understandable. It's already a hefty pack in terms of a locomotive. So, that was the Caledonia Works LNER Gresley A3 Pacific for Train Simulator Classic. I hope you all enjoyed the video, and I will see you all next time. Goodbye.